If we was one of those ratty boys,
stood there with my neighbor called Peter in a flat skirt passer.
He told me he built a time machine, wanted to film a scene. Yeah, he said I've been to the year 3000, not much has changed, but they lived underwater. And your great 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 granddaughter is divine.
Get in, loser, we're going shopping!
What's up, dude?
What's up, Mark?
Did you just call Mean Girls?
Shopping.
And I saw everything.
Boy bands, and another one, and another one,
and another one.
Girls there with round hair, like Star Wars, and float up on the floor. We drove around in a time machine, like what in a film or scene. Yeah.
He said I've been to the year 3000. Not much has changed, but they lived underwater. And your great, great, great granddaughter is divine, divine.
12 seconds later.
Hi, hi, hi.
What's up?
I was 5 years ago, and I come back to make y'all happy, right?
Devin, do you do a freeze frame?
What's a freeze frame?
Look at that camera. Just look at it and go like. What's up, guys? Welcome to the gathering 2020.
Woo!
Destiny, youth and young adults. It's good to be with you guys. Please join us on our carpool karaoke. Mark Reyes, take it away, brother.
All right, so I have the best song on the entire planet. All right, you guys ready?
Let's hear it.
You guys ready?
This is my
greatest
song!
Hey. Bring the beat in!
Anything for you, Beyonce?
Woo. Let's get it! Name the first five countries that come to your mind.
USA, France, Switzerland. I forgot. Hey, that's not good. Yeah, that's
these are new countries.
Oh my gosh. She said Africa.
Did I ever tell you that time my brother, we were playing a game, and they said, name a girl in the Bible, and you said Genesis?
Oh my god.
That's rough.
That made me remind me of that.
That's good.
Well.
Alright, so who's next? Maddie?
Maddie?
Oh, I have the perfect.
Oxcore is all yours.
Song.
Let's hear it.
You ready for this?
Yes, I'm super
it's
excited.
It's got the sickest beat.
I've heard Maddie has the best taste in music, so
everybody
I'm
knows that she's. Yeah, let me look at it real quick. Maddie has the best taste in music in this vehicle.
Yep, 100%. Yes. You know, she was a recording artist, too. Her Spotify playlist is actually one of the most downloaded in corporate parties.
Huge.
In corporate parties, okay.
Big time.
All right, here it comes. Ready?
All right, we're ready. Ready. I'm ready to get hyped, Maddie.
Hold on. It says it's playing, but it's not playing.
Is it
there
up?
There you go, it's playing.
Is volume up?
Yeah, volume up.
Oh, there we go.
I'm so excited. So, Grace Youth Worship Team
Let's
will be
go.
Leading worship for us tonight. I'm super stoked. I hear they're phenomenal. And they're just going to be it's going to be awesome.
Hey, what are the chances Pastor Manny is lead singing?
Oh.
You know,
I'd pay money to see that.
I would too. But you know how I'm a terrible singer.
Right.
He's not quite my level of terrible, but he's there.
He's
like he's there. Almost there. But he can play keys, so I can see him on the keys for worship, but not really singing out there with them.
Okay, right on. David?
Yes, sir.
Oxcord's all yours, brother. Ooh. Take us home. Something
this right here, this is how you get your Friday night started right here.
Okay.
All right, check it.
Okay.
All right.
You're on the phone. Girlfriend, she's upset. She's going off about something that you said. 'Cause she doesn't get your humor like I do. I'm in the room, it's a typical Tuesday night. I'm listening to the kind of music she doesn't like. And she'll never know your story like I do. But she wears short. Been here the whole time. If you could see that I'm the one who understands.
with
me. I think my phone died. Sorry.
Name five dinner meals.
Mac and cheese. Chicken fried steak. Country fried steak. Fried steak. Dang it. Well, carpool karaoke. We're back at the church.
It's fun.
The Gathering Conference 2020.
Hey, super excited.
Let's go. Destiny Conference.
Let's go.
Youth and young adults. Yes. It's going to be awesome. We're going to throw it over to Pastor Manny and the Grace Youth Worship Team right now. We'll see y'all next time.
What's up, everybody? We're so glad you could join us tonight for worship. Wherever you're at, I ask you to just raise your hands with us. Clap, shout. We're going into the presence of God. Y'all ready? Come on, sing this.
Your blood. We love you, Jesus. There is a promise. once beyond my failure, and there is a still voice to silence all my fears. Even the worst of my mistakes are miracles in the making, are miracles in the making. By your stripes
made whole. You have carried a burden too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now, I'm laying it down, and I know that I need you. I run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, the reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I'll run to the Father again.
even through the uncertainty and the chaos and the confusion of what's happening right now, God has continued to grow me through it. And I continue to see his hand in my life because of the peace that surpasses understanding that he's given me.
Probably the hardest moment in my life so far has been when my family moved to Florida for 6 months.
A hard circumstance that I went through that I couldn't control was losing my mom at the age of 13. And I was so mad and I was confused and I was frustrated and I just didn't understand why it was happening.
We've all kind of been through some really tough times, and I know I've been through some really tough times, like right now.
As a result of me struggling with pornography, there came a lot of unworthiness in my mind and a lot of self-doubt that came with it.
God has really just opened my eyes, changed my perspective, and awakened dreams inside of me that wouldn't have happened if we kept living in the norm.
When I feel at my weakest, and when I feel like I can't get up and take the next step to keep pushing towards the finish line and just keep trying and getting back up, that God's carrying me through it. When I feel like I can't get up, he picks me up and he's carrying me through this hard time and he's gonna see me through the finish line.
But in that season, God really put me in a discomfort zone. And through that discomfort, I really grew through him.
And I ran to God about those insecurities about myself and about my past.
And so with that, this year, my word for the year is healing. And with healing, I remember this verse, Isaiah 41:10, and it says, "So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand."
So even though it was very hard and very confusing at what was gonna happen next with our world, God did it for a reason and my pain was for purpose. And now I know I'm perfectly positioned right where I need to be.
God is bigger than what you're going through. God is bigger than the storm. God's bigger than the trials that you're facing. God is bigger, better, and stronger.
And I ran to him and he made me bigger, better, and stronger.
It just made me better and stronger through that season of discomfort.
So in these hard times that we're going through right now, whatever phase you're in, you're going to get through this because we're going to be bigger, better, and stronger. I love you guys. See you later.
Well, welcome, Destiny family, and everyone that is watching, all the youth and young adults and youth groups around the nation. We are here in Arkansas shooting this message, and I'm excited to preach to you guys, but not just preaching to you guys, I'm preaching to all of our River Student Summer interns right here at the River in Searcy, Arkansas. Interns, put your hands together and make some noise. Awesome, awesome, awesome. For those that don't know me, my name is Jared Moss. I'm the Youth and Young Adults Pastor at my home church called The River, church I love, church that I came to Christ in some 12 years ago. It's been a hot minute. Anyhow, every summer we do this internship, and it's my favorite time of the year. And we started a few years ago with 8 students, and then it was 7 the next year, and then it was 10 or 12 or something, then 15. And I thought that was awesome, but I was shocked this year whenever we ended up with like 30 interns. And all of you guys and your beautiful faces, I love y'all so much. Oh, so much. Love you oh so much. We'll go with that. Oh, so much. I love you oh so much. And we love you guys that are watching and joining us as well. Hope you guys enjoyed the pre-service time and the worship. And after the service tonight online on Instagram, you can find our Destiny Instagram account, which is at Destiny Serve. We're going to be doing an AirPods giveaway. If you jump on and hang out with us in the after party, Caleb Rivera and the team from Riverside Church in Victoria, Texas are going to be heading that up. So jump on Instagram right after the sermon. But for now, I get the awesome opportunity to preach the word of God to you guys. Are y'all ready to hear a word from the Lord tonight? Come on, are you ready? All right, awesome. Hey, listen, open up your Bibles to the book of Judges. The book of Judges. And Judges is early on in the historical books. It's the second historical book, because if you remember, we got Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. And there's one more book before Judges. Which is it? Pop quiz. Joshua. That's right, Joshua. And then the next book is, say it with me, say Judges. Judges chapter 13, and I'm excited to preach a very familiar passage to you guys this evening, and it is going to be a challenging word, maybe one that you heard growing up in Bible school, maybe it's one that you read recently, but I think there's something for us all in it today. Judges chapter 13,
And we are going to start in verse 1. Are you guys with me? Got it? Awesome, awesome. Turn to the person next to you. Say, you ready? If you're at home and you're watching with somebody, say, you ready? And if you're not with anybody, just type amen and say, I'm ready. All right. Judges 13, verse 1. Again, the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord delivered them into the hand of the Philistines for 40 years. Now, there was a certain man from Zorah of the family of the Danites whose name was Manoah. How would you guys like to be named Manoah? No? None of you guys? Not at all? Manoah? Okay, cool. I would pass too. And his wife was barren and had no children. And the angel of the Lord appeared to the woman and said to her, indeed now you are barren and have borne no children. Do you guys just love the Bible, how obvious it is? It's like, thank you. But you shall conceive and bear a son. Verse 4. Now therefore, please be careful not to drink wine or similar drink and not to eat anything unclean. For behold, you shall conceive and bear a son. And watch this. No razor shall come upon his head. For the child shall be a Nazarite to God from the womb, and he shall begin to deliver Israel out of the hands of the Philistines. I'm just going to skip forward on my own to verse 24 through 25, same chapter. It says, so the woman bore a son and called his name. Everybody say his name with me. Say Samson. Samson, and the child grew, and the Lord blessed him. And the Spirit of the Lord began to move upon him. I want to talk to you guys for a few moments tonight from the title and the subject. If you're taking notes, you can write this title. Write this. You can't cut my hair. You can't cut my hair. Let's pray. Father, thank you, God, for the opportunity to preach your word today. I ask you, Holy Spirit, that you would just give us eyes of understanding. Lord, the spirit of wisdom and revelation, that our eyes would be opened up, Lord, that we may understand and comprehend the depths and the riches and the beauty of your word tonight, and that we would be forever changed in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, 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 amen. Have you guys ever done something stupid? Like royally stupid? How many of you guys actually just thought of one main stupid thing right now? Like the main thing, like, dang, I remember that. That was stupid. My main question, though, is how many of you have done the same stupid thing over and over and over again, knowing it was stupid and for some reason expecting it to be different, but yet understanding that it actually was stupid again? Am I the only one? No? You guys with me? Okay. I'm sure if you're at home, you're with me as well. I was thinking about this earlier. I remember a long time ago, I had a buddy named Cameron. Cameron was my lifetime best friend. We would get in fights all the time. He lived at the road from me. We'd usually hang out, beat the heck out of each other. Then one of us would show up at the other one's doorstep every single day and say, I'm sorry, bro. We're best friends, right? And that was like our relationship. Well, that was from the time we were like 2 years old all the way until we were like 18 years old. And I remember I went with him and his dad up to Heber Springs at one point because his dad had to pick up some Sea-Doos. I don't even understand really the context. I can't really remember the full context. But I remember we had to get these jet skis across the lake. They didn't tell me that. So whenever we get to the lake, I remember I show up and I'm fully dressed. I'm fully clothed. My friend Cameron says, hey man, ride the jet ski with me across the lake. I have my phone in my pocket. I'm fully dressed again, fully clothed, no shorts, no swim trunks, nothing. I was like, I'm not going to do that. That's, everybody say stupid. That's stupid. He's like, no, bro, it'll be cool. It'll be great. I'm like, Cameron, no, it won't, because Cameron is a jerk. And I know what Cameron's capable of, because his mama, he was one of those kids that had like rich grandparents. So they had the jet skis and he could do all the tricks on them and stuff. And I knew that if I got on that jet ski with him, I was not coming off the jet ski dry. But he's like, no, man, it's going to be great. It's going to be great. I'm like, no, it's going to be, say it with me, stupid. It's going to be stupid. But I decided to get on the jet ski anyway. And all was good and well for about 2 minutes until he started doing donuts on the jet ski. And I told him, stop, you jerk, I hate you, I told you stop. And he just said, ha, one more big donut, fell off the lake, drenched completely from head to toe, ruined my phone. This is a legit story, it actually happened. So I rode all the way home from Heber Springs. If you're not familiar with Central Arkansas, that's a nice little lake town about 30 minutes away that we like to go to. And completely soaked from head to toe, promising myself that I would never trust Cameron again, because Cameron gets me into things that are, say it with me, stupid. I remember another time whenever I was a kid, I used to have this habit of filming myself doing stupid things. And I had this scooter, a little Razor scooter, you know, the ones that like hit you in the shins and hurt really bad. And at our house, we lived out in the country on some acreage, and we had this big concrete slab going up to our garage, and it was like a 2-foot drop off to the yard, okay? And I remember that I would have this great idea that I would do a bunny hop on the scooter off of that onto like dirt for no reason and film myself doing it on this big fat camera because we didn't have phones like all you Gen Zers did back then. And I thought to myself, I probably shouldn't do that. That's stupid. But I did it anyways, and I fell and hurt myself. But I didn't hurt myself that bad. So I got up again, and I was like, crushed it. I'm going to do it again. And I did it again and hurt myself a little bit more. This last time, I was like, I should probably stop because that, say it with me, stupid. But I decided to do it anyways, and I'll never forget coasting off of that thing, turning backwards, and only the back of my head catching the concrete slab. After I came to, I took my camera, I rewound and deleted that footage so that nobody would ever see it. And then I kept doing it again because I was stupid. I was young and stupid. I think all of us can remember times we did something really stupid. Not just times that we did something stupid, but habits that were really stupid. That if somebody asked you, why are you doing that? You wouldn't have a good reason to tell them, but you kept doing it anyway. Think of like a boyfriend or a girlfriend that you know you shouldn't date. Your friend says, don't date him. That's stupid. He's gonna break your heart. Now that he loves me. You're like, no, he said that to the last 5 girls and broke up with them too and broke their heart. Don't date him. That would be, come on, say it with me, stupid. And you're like, no, 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 I'm different. Because different is the language of dumb. Anytime you think you're different like that in that way, like, oh, it won't happen to me again like it happened to everybody else. Yeah, it will. And I remember dating girls like this, doing things like this, and I would suffer the consequences for being stupid. I don't have a problem saying stupid because whether or not you guys, you interns knew this, stupid is in the Bible. I love it in the Proverbs. It says to despise correction is stupid. Listen, if you ever felt stupid or did something stupid, you are actually in good stupid company because the people of God that he called and loved and made his own kind of did the same stupid stuff. If you don't know much about the scripture, God shows up, tells this dude named Abraham in Genesis, yo, I'm going to bless you and I'm going to make you a father of many nations. He's like, great, you're going to have a son. He's like, my wife can't have kids. He's like, don't worry about that. I'm going to hook you up. It's going to happen. Abraham has Isaac. Isaac has Jacob. Jacob has 12 sons. They become Israel. Israel's enslaved by Moses. Not enslaved by Moses. Whoops. Fact check. Enslaved by Egypt, God raises up Moses to deliver the children of Israel into the wilderness, give them the Ten Commandments, send them the prophets to point them to their Messiah, who ends up being Jesus. Jesus comes, dies on the cross, raised on the third day, sends the Holy Spirit, starts the church. That's where we at today. Give God some praise for his great redemption plan wherever you're at, that we are in the new covenant, not the old. But there's this spot right around the book that we're in tonight, where the children of Israel got themselves into some bad habits. You see, the children of Israel were a stubborn people, and the Lord delivers them from slavery. Picture this, a couple million Jews being whipped and beaten by the Egyptians, forced to make their stuff, and God shows up through Moses, delivers them with his mighty hand through plagues to show, I'm the boss, these are my people, let them go. And it doesn't take long when they're in the wilderness at all for them to all start complaining. They said very dumb things like, man, it was better in Egypt because we had meat in Egypt. Out here, we've just got manna. And God was like, okay, you want that? I'll make meat come out of your nostrils. He fed them with so much meat, they got sick of it and asked for the bread again. They would begin to complain and say, it was better in Egypt. It was better back whenever we were slaves. It was better back then. It was better. It was better. They complained against Moses so bad and against God that God actually made them wander for 40 years in Israel until the whole generation died off to teach them a lesson. Because let me tell you something. Complainers will never be successful people. If your friends are gossipers and slanders and complainers, you need to get yourself a new set of friends. Positive people will inherit God's promises, but complainers will become their complaint and drop dead in the wilderness. That's not on my notes, but that's a word for somebody watching today. But the children of Israel were always quick to forget God's redemption and love for them and go back to their idols. Say idols. idols, these poles and these false gods that they would worship and so on and so forth. And they would be so quick to forget God's deliverance and redemption and blessing for them and go back and worship false gods and enter into idolatry. I've got a 5-year-old daughter and I'm teaching her the Ten Commandments right now. And she could tell you the Ten Commandments and right out of the gate, you know, is I'm the Lord, don't have any other gods before me. And right after that is don't make what? Idols. In other words, do not give your attention, your worship, your affection, or your adoration to anyone or anything else but me and me alone, God, because only God can satisfy you. That's the command. But Israel was really bad about doing that. They would always enter back into idolatry. So here's the thing. Whenever I was in 10th grade geometry class and I was terrible at math, I had this friend named Lexis, all right? And every day I would come into math class and I would ask her for a pencil because I didn't bring my own pencils. Y'all ever have one of those friends that just doesn't show up prepared but they expect you to carry them? Like you, just honest question. You ever opened up a pack of gum in a public school classroom? What happens? Hey man, can I have one of those? It ain't like 5 seconds till the pack of gum's just empty, right? It's the same effect when you open up a package of pencils. And every day I'd ask Lexis for a pencil. And every day she'd give me one. Hey, Lexis, let me get a pencil. Bring your own. No, no, come on, Lexis, I will tomorrow. Let me get a pencil. Fine, here's your pencil. I'd do it every day. Let me get a pencil, Lexis. You know, you need to be responsible, Jared. Bring your own pencil. Come on, Lexis, don't be like that. I'll bring one tomorrow. Give me a pencil. Let me get a pencil, Lexis. Fine, here's a pencil. I don't even know where she got all the pencils. I mean, who carries that many pencils? It was like 40. I mean, just bam, bam, bam. So one day we have a test. And it's like a semester exam. It's like a really big one, right? And I show up for the test, and I don't have a pencil. And I was like, Lexis, psst, let me get a pencil. She looked at me, looked at the test on my desk, and goes, no. And I was like, wait, what? She's like, get your own pencil. And she didn't give me a pencil, y'all. The children of Israel who needed miracles from God all the time were quick to forget him. And there comes a point, even in the wonderful grace of God, where he is fresh out of pencils. You guys hear what I'm saying? God eventually, though he loves his children so much, will give you over to the thing that you idolize. Because he knows that if you get a little taste of that thing, you might actually come to your senses and want to come back. And the book of Judges is where we find ourselves in that, because Israel, when God delivers them, he leads them by his prophets, Moses and them, and he sets them up in Canaan, and he gives them a group of leaders, one after the other, called, everyone say judges. Judges. And a judge would come and lead Israel, and they would serve not only as someone who would call Israel back to worshiping God alone, but also as a military leader that God would raise up to defeat them from their enemies, which was overwhelmingly most of the time the Philistines. Everybody say Philistines. Philistines. And so God would raise up these judges whenever his people would cry out and say, God, we're sorry. We keep fornicating and giving ourselves to idols and sacrificing our children. We're sorry. And God would raise up a judge and say, okay, you repented. Here's your judge, and set them free from their enemies. And they'd be like, yeah, God loves us. He set us free. I'm going to church every Sunday. And then like 4 weeks later, you couldn't find them. And they'd be back. Where are they at? Oh, they're back worshiping the Baal again. They're back with the idols again. And God'd be like, guys, are you serious? And so over time, he'd be patient with them, and then he would just let them have their idols again until the enemies come back and overtake them. And they say, God, the Philistines are on us again. You know, deliver us again. And he would give them a judge and raise a judge up, and he'd deliver them. And they'd be like, yeah, we love God. We're going to church every Sunday. I'm going to keep my virginity till our wedding night because you're so good, God. And then like 4 or 5 weeks later, where are they at again? Oh, I saw her over with some dude, you know. And God's like, bro, are you serious? Again, and just give them back over, over and over. Well, God breaks the mold a little bit, though, at one point, because he raises up a man that we're talking about tonight named Samson. Who? Samson. And Samson's a little bit of a different breed, because Samson is what's called a Nazarite. Now, if you're not familiar with a Nazarite was a type of individual who had a vow. You could either be a temporary Nazarite for a season of time, or a lifetime Nazarite from birth, like Samson was, because the angel told his parents that he's going to be a Nazarite, you're going to dedicate him, and from his womb, he shall be a Nazarite. The word Nazarite is a noun form that literally means the verb separate or consecrate. So a Nazirite is somebody who was set apart and separated from the rest. In other words, they were different. You know, even in the church, even in the people that are saved and born again, God calls us to be different. Amen? Did you know none of your works or your good righteous little deeds that you think can actually save you? The Bible says that our works and our good deeds are as filthy rags to the Lord. Because all of us were in need of a Savior. And thank God that it wasn't dependent upon me and my good works, but the Lord sent Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, who was perfect from the Father, who never sinned, to lay his life down on a cross, shed his blood, so that when I put my faith and trust in him for salvation rather than my own self, I'm covered in his blood, I'm washed in the blood, my sins are gone, I'm a new creation in Christ, and I am looked at by the Father as holy and saved, and I am delivered, and I am a Christian, not because of anything I've done, but because of everything he did. Amen? But some people will take that grace, just like the deliverance from Israel, and say, I'm free from Egypt. I'm free from hell. I ain't going to burn whenever I die. And then they will take that freedom and they will begin to go against God's word and do the things that he says not to do. Have you ever known somebody that's a half-hearted Christian? Jesus calls them lukewarm. In the book of Revelation, Jesus says, I'd rather you be hot or cold, not lukewarm, for I will spit you out of my mouth. It's the type of Christian that says, man, you know, I know that God's word says don't sleep with your boyfriend, but you know, it's his grace. And you start to ask like, man, how do you just say that? Like, how can you bear the name of someone who died for you and then not do what they ask? And they'll say something like, man, that's what forgiveness is for. You're like, it doesn't work that way. Can you imagine if I cheated on my wife and you're like, hey, bro, stop cheating on your wife with that girl. And I was like, nah, Evelyn's great. She'll forgive me. That's what forgiveness is for. We're married. Like, how do y'all think that's going to go on Evelyn's end? That's how we are. The Bible says that we're the bride of Christ. And whenever we willfully commit sin, we're like an adulterous bride. And Samson was a set apart individual. And you are called to be set apart as well, a Nazirite. Now, here's what a Nazirite would be, okay? A Nazirite was set apart, holy, separate. It's a reflection of the image of God because we find out that God's overwhelming attribute all throughout the scripture is a four-letter word that starts with H called holy. In fact, when Isaiah saw the Lord, he saw it and he heard them identify him as holy. Whenever John saw Jesus in the Revelation, he saw the four living creatures and heard them crying out day and night, holy, holy, holy. In other words, God is holy. He is separate, he is different, he is other. Just like oil doesn't mix with water, God cannot mix with sin. Righteousness cannot cohabitate with that which is unrighteous. And the Lord has set his people apart to be distinguished from the rest of the earth. Samson was distinguished. And here's what a Nazirite would have to do, or couldn't do, should I say. They couldn't drink wine, can't have alcohol. You'll hear Christians debate that kind of stuff. Well, you can, the scripture says you can. I heard a preacher in one of the great awakenings that was used by God to heal so many sick and raise dead people. His saying was, others may, but I may not. He would look at his own Christian brothers and sisters that would fight for their own individual liberties and be like, I want to have a drink of alcohol. And be like, you knock yourself out, but me, I'm different. I'm set apart. You'll have friends that are like, it's okay to listen to Ariana Grande and Nicki Minaj. And you're like, hey, you knock your socks off. Not this dude. I will not tolerate that sort of idolatry. Y'all, when I first gave my life to Jesus Christ, I loved this terrible show called Family Guy. And in that show, they openly make fun of and blaspheme God. I had these three discs because back then we had to watch stuff on these like little CDs called DVDs. You guys don't know this because you have Apple TVs and Rokus and all that kind of junk and Disney Plus right now. But I gave my life to Christ and God convicted me about that. And I came home and I took those DVDs and I threw them in a trash bag. Because you know what goes in the trash bag? Trash. And I wasn't going to watch that trash anymore. I had found something better to gaze at, and I didn't need that kind of junk in my life anymore. It's like when you cut toxic people out, just like, see ya, I don't need that in my life anymore. And I'll never forget the guy that was mentoring me at that time in the faith. And I told him I did that. And he said, why did you do that? I would have loved to have had those. And I was so shocked. I was like, no, I'm a Christian. Like, I don't want to watch stuff that mocks my Savior. He died for me. You know, did you not get that? He said, Jared, listen, I know that you're young right now and you're new in the faith and you can't really handle some of that stuff, but when you mature a little bit, you can dabble a little bit. You can handle some of that. And I remember thinking, that's off. I hadn't been to Bible college. I hadn't done the internship, none of that. But I knew that was off. Some of us are called to be set apart. Do you know the greater your consecration, the greater your anointing on your life? Samson couldn't drink wine. Samson couldn't touch a dead carcass. In fact, Nazarites were so set apart that if your own family died, you couldn't go near the body because you were set apart. And the final attribute of a Nazarite is this: you couldn't cut your hair. Now, I got to tell you, I don't really get this so much other than the fact that as I was praying about this, I feel like the Holy Spirit told me that holiness will always work itself outward to where people will notice the difference on your life. Samson had these long, long locks of hair, probably. In fact, if you ever saw the Bible, the show that they did and portrayed him, he was a big black dude with these dreadlocks. He looked sick. That's probably not what he looked like, but he looked sick in that show. But Samson had his long hair, and he had this superhuman strength. Everybody say strength. Samson was crazy, man. Samson got mad one time, just killed 30 people. Just 30 dudes, dead. Killed them. And that was one time. Another time, this book of Judges, you can read this right here in the scripture. It says that he got even more upset at the Philistines, who always represent the enemy, the devil, Satan, and all his demons and henchmen who come against the people of God. And so he took these two foxes, or not two foxes, sorry, he took 300 foxes, took them in pairs, put their tails together, tied flaming torches on fire between their two tails, and let them run loose through the grain fields, and he burned all the grain fields and all the vineyards. Like, how does one even do that? Like, how do you tie fox tails together that they're still alive, much less 150 pairs of them? Dude was a boss. At one point, the Philistines actually captured him in his first run-in with compromising with a girl, and he's bound. The Spirit of the Lord comes upon him. He breaks off the bindings. It says he finds I love how it says fresh. The Bible says a fresh donkey jawbone and kills 1,000 dudes in one go with a donkey jawbone. That's pretty lit, I gotta say. This is the kind of strength that Samson had. And yet, even Samson, turn to your neighbor and say, even Samson. Even Samson had a weakness. Even Samson had a weakness. In Judges 14, moving on from 13, verses 1 through 3, we see it. It says, now Samson went down to Timnah and saw a woman in Timnah of the daughters of the Philistines. So he went up and told his father and mother, saying, I have seen a woman in Timnah of the daughter of the Philistines. Now therefore, get her for me as a wife. Then his father and mother said to him, is there no woman among the daughters of your brethren or among all my people? In other words, can't you marry a Christian? Why you want to get an unsaved girl? That you must go and get a wife from the uncircumcised Philistines? And Samson said to his father, get her for me, for she pleases me well. One of the translations, I think is the NLT, flat out says, she looks good to me. That was Samson's threshold qualification for the woman he was going to marry. Get her for me. She looked good. You boys, you know you don't marry a girl just because she looks right, right? Looks deceit. And same for girls. It don't matter how he looks, and it don't matter how much money he has. Samson had a weakness, and his weakness is revealed right here. He wanted a woman, and he wanted the wrong woman. She looks good. I'll take her. And you got to understand something. If you've got a weak spot in your life, the devil, no matter how strong you are or set apart you think you are or what the calling on your life is, will always find that weak spot and expose it and use it to ruin the purpose and the plans for God on your life. In fact, many of you guys probably remember when you first gave your life to Jesus, or you've been to a church camp, or you've been to a youth encounter, or you've been somewhere where you felt the presence of God for the first time so strong, and you remember bawling your eyes out, Jesus, I give you my life. I'm yours. I won't do A, B, C, D anymore. Only to compromise about 2 or 3 weeks into the school year, then feel guilt and shame for it, and instead of repent and confess to somebody who loves you and is for you, continue in a downward spiral, and then you wake up somewhere in the middle of your school year and wonder, where did that emotion and that feeling last summer go? Simply because of the compromise whenever you were enticed. Samson really messes up whenever he meets this girl named Delilah. Say Delilah. Delilah. Chapter 16, it says, beginning in verse 4, afterward, in other words, after everything he did with all his superhuman strength, No matter how strong and anointed he was, it happened that he loved a woman in the Valley of Sorek whose name was Delilah. And the lords of the Philistines came up to her and said to her, "Entice him and find out where his great strength lies and by what means we may overpower him." Watch this. This is what the devil says about you. "That we may bind him or her to afflict him or her, and every one of us will give you 1,100 pieces of silver." So Delilah said to Samson, "Please tell me where your great strength lies and with what you may be bound to afflict you." And Samson said to her, "If they bind me with 7 fresh bowstrings not yet dried, then I shall become weak and be like any other man." So the lords of the Philistines brought up to her 7 fresh bowstrings not yet dried, and she bound him with them. Now men were lying in wait, staying with her in the room, and she said to him, "The Philistines are upon you, Samson," to wake him up. But he broke the bowstrings as a strand of yarn breaks when it touches fire. So the secrets of his strength were not known. So she asks him again later, like, "Dang, that didn't work. Come on, Samson, tell me what's your real strength. Tell me where your strength really lies. Why did you mess with me? Tell me the truth." And he tells her another thing, and it doesn't work. And she comes to him again. Tell me, Samson, tell me where your strength really lies. And he tells her another thing, and it doesn't work. "Come on, Samson. Come on. Don't you love me? Tell me." And he tells her another thing, and guess what? Again, it doesn't work. But you see, the enemy is very cunning, because if he can't get in through the front door, he'll come in through the side door. If he can't get into your life through drug addiction, he'll get in through alcohol. If he can't get in through alcohol, he'll get in through a boyfriend. If he can't get in through a boyfriend, he'll get in through something else. The enemy will find your pressure point, guaranteed. And the sad part is, if he asks you enough and dresses up cute enough and paints up and puts his lip gloss on enough, pretties up enough, says, "Check out this apple," just like he did to Eve, "look at this fruit," enough, at some point you may even be the one that tells him what your problem is and give him access. So verse 15, then she said to him, "How can you say I love you when your heart is not with me, Samson? You've mocked me 3 times and have not told me where your great strength lies." And it came to pass when she pestered him daily with her words and pressed him so that his soul was vexed to death. What a terrible woman. That he told her all his heart. And he said to her the truth. He said, "No razor has ever come upon my head, for I have been a Nazarite to God from my mother's womb. I am shaven. If I'm shaven, then my strength will leave me, and I shall become weak and be like any other man." When Delilah saw that he had told her all his heart, she sent and called for the Lord of the Philistines. This is the sad part. Saying, "Come up once more, for he has told me all his heart." So the Lord of the Philistines came up to her and brought the money in their hand. It's just like when Judas sold Jesus out for 30 pieces of silver. Satan found Judas's weak spot so that he can manipulate him into selling out the Savior that loved his soul. Verse 19, then she lulled him to sleep on her knees and called for a man and had him shave off the 7 locks of Samson's head. Then she began to torment him. Say torment. And his strength left him. And she said, "The Philistines are upon you, Samson." So he awoke from his sleep. Watch this. And said, "I will go out as before at other times and shake myself free. I'll just borrow another pencil. The Lord's always been with me. It's always been the same. I can fake it till I make it." Except no, he did not know that the Lord had departed from him. Then the Philistines took him and put out his eyes. They gouged his eyes out, brought him down to Gaza. They bound him with bronze fetters, and he became a grinder in the prison. This is a heartbreaking thing. I know that when I first came to Christ, I was on fire for the Lord, and I began to preach. I started a Bible club. I started preaching to 76 students every single week in my high school. I accepted invitations to go preach at other churches, and I always was able to tap into that anointing. But I'll never forget whenever a certain sin began to creep up in my life and I didn't deal with it or confess it with somebody, that I had a moment where I was trying to prepare a message and I thought I had this thing down, and I had the microphone in my hand and I began to preach and I did not have anything to say. I did not feel the presence of the Lord. I didn't feel the anointing of the Lord. I had this strong sense that God was no longer with me. I knew God was in me, it would never leave me or forsake me, because his promise is that. But you know the Holy Spirit, though he lives within you forever, eternally, and you're sealed for the day of redemption. The Bible says plainly the Holy Spirit comes upon people in different manifest encounters. And I'll never forget whenever I realized the anointing of the Lord was not on me anymore. And I had to make a decision. Do I want God more than that? The Bible says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. You know the reward for purity isn't a hot wife one day. I used to think it was. God, if I stay a virgin and I'm pure, I'll have a hot virgin wife one day and everything will be great. Thank you. Let's make a deal, God. No. The reward for purity is seeing him. And when you can't see him, when you can't hear him, and when you can't feel him, it's heartbreaking. And it leads you, because of the lack of identity and affirmation, like some of us learned earlier, to go and make more terrible decisions to try to fill that void with things and people and popularity and fame. And you fake it and you put your mask on and you try to work it up, but you know that something's missing and something has departed from you. I have a question to all you guys in here and everybody watching today. If you were that zealous person at one time, if you weren't afraid and ashamed to tell of your faith and preach the gospel, you didn't give a flip what anybody thought about you, you remember you were so in love with the Lord, or you've just had a sense since you were born that God has a purpose for your life. I just grew up knowing that there was something special God was calling me to before I ever even knew it was God. Before I ever thought of ministry, I was afraid to talk to people. I couldn't be caught dead talking in public like this. I said I didn't want to be a preacher because I hated those guys because they told me everything that I was doing wrong and I didn't like that. All these things, and yet I knew that I was destined for a purpose. And if you are in that category where you know that you were set apart, you were apprehended for such a time as this, or you just trust that God knitted you together in your mother's womb, which all of you have been, but you've lost that passion, you've lost that zeal, you've entered into the fear of man and you've lost the fear of the Lord, and you don't feel the love and the anointing and the passion and the presence of God on your life, it is probable and possible that your head has been in the wrong lap. You let somebody take something from you. You let something take something from you. The enemy works so many ways. He seduces you. She seduced him first. We know from Samson, if she didn't look good, he wasn't about it. So I'm sure she was a knockout. I'm sure she was gorgeous. You know, the enemy always paints himself up real pretty, like it's a good offer. Seduces you, lulls you into a slumber. She got him good and asleep. 1 Thessalonians 5:6, the Apostle Paul tells the church, I beg you, stay awake. And the church is in a slumber right now. It's a prophetic word for the church. I feel like a lot of the church has no idea the agenda of the enemy that's actually pervading society. And we just go on Sunday to Sunday, youth service to youth service, and don't even know the war that's waging all the time. Just asleep. If he can get you asleep, he binds you. He begins to slip secret sin and things into your life, and you know you can feel the tug. You don't feel like you're a slave yet. I can quit whenever I want. It's just a little bind. It's just a little bowstring. I could probably break it. I just don't want to. I could quit whenever I want to. I just don't want to. I could stop clicking on that website, but like, you know, I'm not ready to yet. I know I need to break up with him or her, but like, I'm just not ready to yet. But I probably could if I needed to, like if it got real bad. Yeah. You may not be a slave yet, but you're bound. He begins to shear you, begins to cut off the source of your relationship with God. There goes the Bible time. There goes the prayer time. There goes your hair. Gouges your eyes out to where you have no vision. If you're a pastor or a leader, and maybe it's been a long time since you've seen anything from the Lord, perhaps your head's been in the wrong lap. If you're a young person, can't make sense of anything, feel like you're fumbling around and standing in darkness, it may be, I'm not saying it happened. Maybe possible that your head's been in the wrong lap. And finally, after he gouges your ears, he enslaves you. Gouges your eyes, he enslaves you. They took him down to Gaza. They put him in a prison. And the phrase, it says they made him, everybody say a grinder. A grinder. And so now life is just a grind. Isn't that how it is when you do it the enemy's way? Life is a grind. Unplanned pregnancy is a grind. The drug addiction's a grind. The abusive relationship, emotionally, verbally, physically, it's a grind. the fakeness, having to doll yourself up on Instagram and pretty yourself up for a bunch of likes whenever you don't even like the people on the other side of the screen liking you, but for some reason you feel like you need their affirmation. It's a grind. You're a leader. Maybe you're a youth leader. You don't even like your small group. You're just grinding through it. Just grinding through your job at Sonic. No purpose. Don't enjoy it. Just grinding through it. Grinding through the prayer meeting. Grinding through the church services. Fake it till you make it. You keep moving row back. Grinding through the conversations with your parents. It's because in secret, you've been grinding on some gossip. You've been grinding on a wrong relationship. You've been grinding on all kinds of terrible stuff. And life is an absolute grind. It's a sad thing to me, guys, that this is the strongest dude we ever read about in the Bible. Supernatural human strength. Incredible. But he forgot his strength was in the Lord. He took his eyes off God, didn't do it God's way, dabbled in the wrong places. And all it took to take this dude killed 1,000 people with a donkey jawbone. And all it took to take him out was a woman and a nap. A woman and a nap. That simple. And I guess my question to everybody that's in this room right now, and I know we're watching this wherever you're at, but we're also in this room right now. To everybody that's in here, just look at me right now. Look at me right here. And everybody that's watching, look at me real quick. I want to ask you, who has been cutting your hair? For me, it was porn. It was porn. 17 years old, fiery, feeling called to the nations. Could not kick the habit. A slave to my computer. 4 hours a day. I don't even know how it happened. But I bought the lie. I was seduced by a Delilah. Got bound. My eyes are gouged out. Literally, I'm looking with my eyes at 2D images on a screen. And then I'm at a point where I'm saying bye to my family and letting them go have fun without me staying home because I have to feed the master and perform my slave duties. There's a girl who was 19 when I was 16 years old, and I hadn't had a girlfriend since I was in like sixth grade. It was before I came to Christ, about a few months before. And I started talking to her. I met her at a basketball game. It was so lame. And I began to hang out with her, and she told me that she was a Christian, but she had been in a sexual relationship with her boyfriend for 4 or 5 years. And she said, I was coming to church here at the time. She said, I want a guy to help me change. And I remember thinking, you know, big bad Jared knows the Bible a little bit and goes to youth group on Monday nights. Jared, I'll help you change. I meant it. I'll help you change. Well, let me tell you how that went. I was the one that got changed. Because she didn't want Christ. She wanted a boy. And I fell into the trap. And I remember talking to my youth pastor. And he was like, I have a bad feeling about this girl. And I knew what I was doing. I knew what I was doing when nobody was looking. But I'd come up here on Monday night. And I'd lift my hands. And I'd sing the songs. And I would even tell the youth group scriptures and stuff. A full-blown facade. And he told me, Jared, you have an anointing on your life, but you have to be careful because the anointing is like, it's attractive to people. I said, well, at least the anointing attracts right people. He said, no, no, no. And he told me, he's like, Samson and Delilah, bro. He said, you've got to guard what's on your life. Thank God this girl chose the path she did and the Lord split us up right at the right time because it would have cost me a lot more than it did. That summer, I remember giving my life to Jesus Christ when I encountered him at a youth event, much like a sermon you're hearing right now. And I remember I repented of that season. The Lord set me free of that shame, that guilt, that depression, that oppression. And I began to enter into the calling God had on my life. I want to tell you guys something. Porn will cut your hair. Gossip will cut your hair. Wrong relationships will cut your hair. The type of music and movies you listen to will cut your hair. The type of things you watch, the type of things you scroll, the DMs that nobody sees on Snapchat and Instagram will cut your hair. Youth pastors and youth leaders, I want to say this to you. Religion will cut your hair. Churchianity will cut your hair. You got a John the Baptist fiery Samson calling. If you're not careful, you'll go to enough conferences and places and they will slice and refine those things off you to make you look like a pretty boy until you can't say what's in your heart to say because you let someone cut your hair. I think God's given us grace today and And tonight, wherever you're at watching this, everyone that's in here, to take a stand and say, whatever I've lost, I will recover in Jesus' name. You can cut my hair. I want everybody to stand up that's in here. And if you're in your room or you're having a watch party, youth and young adult group, whatever, stand up, because I want to read this verse. Here's the crazy thing about all this. Listen. I love good movies. I love trilogies like Star Wars. I'm not going to go on my Star Wars rant. All my interns know I love Star Wars. I love cliffhangers, a good cliffhanger. Like, what's going to happen next? Binge it on Netflix. You know what I'm saying? Where like the 5-second trailer starts up and you're like, just keep watching, keep watching. If there was a cliffhanger in all of the Bible, this is it. Because after all this, verse 22, watch this verse. However, everybody say however. The hair of his head began to grow again after he had been shaven. I love this. Now the Lord of the Philistines gathered together to offer a great sacrifice to Dagon, their god, and to rejoice. And they said, our God has delivered into our hands Samson, the enemy. The enemies are celebrating. Oh, Jared, we got him. He's a porn addict. It's over. They said, oh, Samson, it's over. We cut his hair off. We got him in the prison. He doesn't even have eyes anymore. And they're dancing and celebrating. And when the people saw him, verse 24, they praised their God, for they said, our God has delivered into our hands our enemy, the destroyer of our land, and the one who multiplied our dead. And so it happened when their hearts were merry that they said, call for Samson that he may perform for us. Because you don't know this, but when Satan's got you, he just mocks you and likes to watch you dance like a puppet on his strings. Hates your soul. Can't wait to have you in the throes of hell with him for eternity. But oh, you're good entertainment for the night, he thought. So they called for Samson from the prison, and he performed for them, and they stationed him between the pillars. Then Samson said to the lad who held him by the hand, let me feel the pillars which support the temple so that I can lean on them. Now the temple was full of men and women. All the lords and the Philistines were there, about 3,000 men and women on the roof watching while Samson performed. You see, sometimes the devil overplays his hand and he doesn't realize where you've placed yours. Because while he was overplaying his hand mocking Samson, he didn't realize that Samson felt his hands up onto the pillars. And he says in verse 28, Samson called to the Lord saying, O Lord God, remember me, I pray. Strengthen me, I pray. Just this once, O God, that I may with one blow take vengeance on the Philistines for my two eyes. And Samson took hold of the two middle pillars which supported the temple. He braced himself against them, one on his right, the other on his left. Then Samson said, let me die with the Philistines. And he pushed with all his might, and the temple fell on the lords and all the people who were in it. So the dead that he killed at his death were more than he had killed in his life. And his brothers and all his father's household came down and took him and brought him up and buried him between Zorah and Eshtaol in the tomb of his father, Manoah. Come on, put your hands together if you believe you serve the God that can do more at the end of your mistake than you ever thought you could do in the middle of your consecration. I want to tell you guys something. No matter where you've been, no matter what you've been into, no matter if your daddy's the pastor, no matter if you fake going to church, you don't like it, no matter if you've never even been to church, and you just know right now the Holy Spirit is speaking to you, and you know that the devil stole something from you and you want it back. Did you know our God is so good that all you got to do is pray a prayer as simple as, God, if you would, just anoint me again. I can't tell you guys how many times I've prayed this prayer because I've sinned and messed up, even in the ministry, and I have to come to moments where I have nothing left in my own strength, and I just pray this prayer, God, would you just anoint me, strengthen me one more time again. Samson came to the place, though, where he was willing to die for his faith. If it meant crushing the enemy's head, that's where we've got to be. And I want to tell you something. If you are ready to make a difference with your life, the first step is this. Die to yourself. Galatians 2:20. I've been crucified with Christ. No longer I who lives, Christ lives within me. I have a word for you. If you will give it all and let your flesh be crucified, I promise you God will cause resurrection life through your physical death for your Holy Spirit, for the Holy Spirit in you to crush the enemy's head for God's great purpose and plan. No matter where you've been, no matter what you've been into, no matter what you've done, all you got to do is ask God to meet you here in this moment. I want you guys to bow your heads and close your eyes. If you're watching, bow your heads, close your eyes. Father, I pray right now, God, that, Lord, you would give us grace to believe you and trust you, that you are the God who never fails us. You are the God who not only calls us, but sustains us. And whenever we repent and cry back out to you, regardless of 1,000 times if we've fallen, you are so good that the righteous will get back up. And tonight, I am asking you, Lord, to awaken the Nazarite cry on the inside of our hearts, where, Lord, we want nothing but you. We want nothing and no one but you, and we will do what you call us to do so that we can make the difference that you've called us to make, to fulfill the purpose, the set apart, holy, consecrated purpose on our life. God, we are different. I love that we're different. And then they mock me, I don't care. If I look stupid, I don't care. If I worship with all my heart until they make fun, I don't care. If I live my life out and preach the gospel when everybody in the cafeteria is mocking, I don't care, because I'm yours, O Lord. And tonight, I thank you, God, that you are raising up the Nazarites, the holy ones. We're not perfect. We're not special. We're just chosen. And we're bold enough to pray this prayer tonight. Come on, in this room and where you're at, repeat after me. Oh Lord, strengthen me again. Anoint me again. Lord, anoint us again. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Come on, in here and where you're at, put your hands together and give God praise. Listen, we love you, and we're believing that the best is yet to come. The destiny thing this year is bigger and better and stronger. And I'm believing that for your life and everybody that's in here. I'm believing it for my own. COVID was crazy. Here we are. We made it. But God's speaking to each and every one of us. And I believe, and this is a word for us in here too, I believe that you will never be the same after this summer. He's so good. He's so gracious. Say goodbye to the past and embrace the future, because God is for you. And if he is for you, as the scripture says, who can be against you? We love you, Destiny family. I love you guys. Have a great night. We will see you in a few on Instagram. And we are going to celebrate what God did just now tonight.
Hey Destiny family, my name is Caleb and I'm the youth pastor here at Riverside Church. We want to thank you so much for being with us for this youth premiere service. I thought we had such an awesome time, and thank you Pastor Jared for delivering such a powerful message as well. And guess what? The fun is not over yet. We're going to be having an after party on the Destiny Instagram. All you have to do is hop on the Destiny Instagram, which is at Destiny Serve. I'm gonna say it again. It's at Destiny Serve, and me and some youth and some leaders are gonna be hanging out on there, playing games, having fun, and we're gonna be giving away some prizes, including a pair of AirPods Pro. That's right, a pair of AirPods Pro. This is gonna belong to one of you guys tonight. So be sure that you go on Instagram, hang out with us, and let's party.